said, "Oh, we are so happy to have you. Good to see our regulars back after our cold weather snap last week. Want to remind you that the heater at the church worked all weekend long. So next time you're sitting at home and it's cold and you're like, oh, should I go to church this morning? Hey, God provides the heat, right? Okay. For those of you that are joining us online, I want to apologize. We started our live stream a little later, so you missed the first song, which is just another reason why you should be here in person, right? Just can't be in person. But we are glad to see you here. Couple of announcements this morning, folks. We have got a busy week. We've got our Methodist Midweek Mission coming up this week. 5:30 is dinner, and then Bible studies at 6 o'clock. I want to just mention that we will be completing our Revelation Bible study this Wednesday. We will be finishing up Revelation. It's going to be, I'm really excited that we managed to, we started this group with around 40. We have finished with 30. And I want to say that is a really strong group to finish with. That's the largest group I've ever finished when it comes to doing this Bible study. Our next Wednesday night Bible study is going to be the book of Isaiah. All right? So if you are interested in the book of Isaiah, which you should be, some call it the Gospel of the Old Testament, I would encourage you to come to that. And that is at 6:15. We have our Bible study at 6:15 on Wednesdays following our dinner at 5:30. Monday, the 22nd, we have a council meeting. All right? That will be upstairs in the youth area. Brief Share will be meeting next door over at the parsonage at our activity house over there. The United Women in Faith will be having their meeting at 10 a.m. upstairs in the youth area on Tuesday. And then at 6 p.m. tonight, we have our upstream family small group for families with children. If you would like to be a part of that, we're going to be meeting at our Andrew and I's house at 6 p.m. If you're interested, just text me and we can get you that information. I do believe that is everything we've got. Yeah, I think that's good. Well, let's now, in our church, what we do, again, if you're a visitor with us this morning, we do what's called passing of the peace. And we do something a little extra here. We call it a passing of the peace and prayer. And what we do is we get up, we greet one another in the morning, we say, hey, how you doing? How's your mom and them? But we also ask, how can I be praying for you this week? All right, so I would encourage us all to stand up and pass the peace and pass the prayer around this morning. we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Yes.
talking to you.
A healthy, beautiful child.
A healthy and beautiful child, absolutely. Thank you.
Yep, right.
Thank you. All right. Are there any concerns that would like to lift it up to congregations for me? Anything anybody would like us to be praying for? Let's go to God in prayer. Merciful God, we give you thanks for this day. And Lord, I just ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that you be present among us right now. That your Holy Spirit fill this room and fill our hearts and souls. God, we have come into this house this morning for a specific purpose. You have brought us here for a reason. We heeded your call this morning when our alarm clock went off. We drug ourselves out of bed. And we came here. Obviously, there is something here that you want us to hear. And so we ask that you give us open hearts and minds and souls to this experience this morning, that it may equip us for the road ahead, that it may equip us for the days ahead, and that we may return next Sunday with stories of joy and celebration of how we have served you this week. We ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, as we pray the prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Esther and from 1 Peter. A reading from Esther. Now, there was a citadel of Susa. Now, there was in the citadel of Susa a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin named Mordecai, son of Jair, the son of Shemaiah, son of Kish, who had been carried into exile from Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. Among those taken captive was Jerachim, king of Judah. Mordecai had a cousin named Hadassah, whom he had brought up because she had neither father nor mother. This young woman, who was also known as Esther, had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Mordecai had taken her as his own daughter when her mother and father died. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please bow your heads in prayer? Merciful God, we ask you now to open our hearts and minds to the message, and let my words be yours. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Today marks the first in a series of sermons where we are going to be going through the book of Esther. Now, I know what some of you may be thinking. Pastor Mike, I thought you were giving sermons about some questions that the congregation proposed to you. Are we taking a break from that? Well, no, actually. One of the questions, matter of fact, I got it at least four times in four different formats, but four different ways, but it was essentially the same question. It was the question of, why doesn't God speak to us the way he did in the Old Testament and in the New Testament? Another question was, why doesn't God speak out loud to us anymore? Or the other one is, why is it so hard for us to hear the voice of God? Or the fourth question was, how do we hear the voice of God? And so I think if you wrap all four of those around, what we're really asking is, how does God speak to us today? And how can we actually hear him today? And one of the problems I think we face as Christians, and I share this problem with many of you before, and in sermons before, is the problem of comparison. All right? The problem of comparison. We are always comparing ourselves to the next person. Right? We are always comparing ourselves to the gifts and strengths of the next person. compare our faults with the next person. You ever notice that? You ever see somebody going, yeah, you know, they're drunk, but if you see me drunk, you never see anybody doing that, right? You don't see that sort of comparison. Yeah, you see that they're illiterate, but I can't even read the dictionary. You know, you don't see that sort of comparison. It's always comparison to the positive, right? And we usually compare ourselves, if we have a low self-esteem, we compare ourselves in a minimum way, and if we have a high self-esteem, usually we kind of feel better than other people. Both ways are not good ways, by the way, all right? Because comparison itself is not something we should be doing. As a matter of fact, there's really only one person we're supposed to compare ourselves to, and that is Jesus Christ. And we're supposed to constantly be trying to expound and live as he lived. But the problem becomes, we see other people's gifts, we have this conversation with spiritualists, we see other people's gifts, and we wonder, why don't I have that gift? Why can't I pray that way? Why can't I preach that way? Why can't I sing that way? Why can't I give a study that way? Now, it also goes back to the issue that we have with how are we supposed to hear the voice of God when he doesn't talk to us. We read about characters in the Old Testament and the New Testament where God steps down and he speaks in a body voice. You know? When he speaks to Moses, right? He says, Moses, take your feet off, you're walking on holy ground. Moses knew exactly what to do. God told Moses exactly what to do. And we see this dialogue going on, but I want to point some truths out to you. In the entire span of the Bible, we're talking about multiple books and chapters and passages. There are very few people with which God speaks to one-on-one. Have you noticed that? There are very few people with which God talks to on a one-on-one basis. Usually, it's God doing a mighty work and the people responding to that mighty work. It's usually God speaking through one individual or speaking through a mighty event, and the people seeing that event and seeing God within the movement of that event. When God parted the Red Sea for the Israelites, he didn't say to the Israelites, I'm about to part the Red Sea. He parted the Red Sea. The Israelites saw it, they witnessed it, and they came to the conclusion, only God could do that. In the same way that when the Israelites were starving in the desert, God provided manna, did he not? Did he say, I'm going to give you manna? No, the manna appeared. And what did the people do? They attributed it to God. Very seldom does God speak audibly to individuals. He speaks through his actions and his prophets. Now, what we tend to do is we tend to say, well, if I could only be spoken to like Moses, only be spoken to God, only God speaks to me like David, like he spoke to David or Saul, then I would believe. Have you read about Moses? Have you read about Saul? You read about David? Were their lives perfect? Even with that direct communication with the Lord, did they lead perfect lives? Did they make mistakes? Oh my gosh, let's just take David for example. David, a man after God's own heart, that scripture tells us. David was a replacement for a king that started with a good connection with God, started being able to hear God, and then refused and rejected that connection. So here we come in. Surely David will learn the lessons of the previous king. And what does David do? Oh, nothing much. He just has his secret lover's husband killed in battle so that he can marry her. That's pretty immoral, if you ask me. Anybody want to get into debate whether that was a moral act or not? Didn't think so. And the reality becomes, even if we want to compare ourselves to those men and women who audibly spoke to God, we see that even their walks in faith were challenged. They struggled. They doubted. Moses doubted whether he would reach the promised land. And by the way, Moses never did reach the promised land. Abraham struggled with his faith. Even after time and time again, God spoke to him. So I want to first dispel the idea that we can have that if God spoke directly to us, all of our problems would go away. That our faith would be rock solid. I guarantee you that the minute God would speak to you or I, the next thought we would have in our head was, that didn't happen. We would immediately descend into doubt. Because that's how life works. That's how sin works. That's how imperfection works. But what if I was to tell you that there was a character in the Bible and a book of the Bible that never even mentioned God once? And yet it is a book about listening, seeing, and responding to God's call. And what if was also to tell you that it was a woman who was the leader in this story. The book of Esther in no place mentions God. It doesn't say the voice of God. It doesn't say the presence of God. It doesn't say Jehovah or any of the other names of God. The only thing that is mentioned is that these are people of the Jewish faith. The author in the book of Esther invites the reader to find God within the text without God having to blatantly make himself known. The author calls us to read into the situation. Esther is the book for the common Israelite. Because the author knows, just like the rest of us today, most people will go their entire lives without hearing the audible voice of God. And yet we are still called to have that same foundation of faith. God chooses unlikely ways and unlikely people to do the impossible. That hasn't changed, by the way. You can look throughout church history where unlikely individuals have been chosen by God, chosen to go into ministry by the Lord, and done amazing things. Did you know that Billy Graham, in his seminary courses, Billy Graham was told that he would never make a good preacher? Anybody ever heard that story? Billy Graham was told by a professor one time that he would never make a good preacher. And his first church, he did really poorly. What he found out was he was not a good pastor. But he was a great evangelist. He could shepherd a flock of 30 in a little North Carolina town, but he could preach revival messages to millions and make the message of Jesus Christ, make the gospel something that was palatable and receivable across culture. cultures. History is full of people. C.S. Lewis. Anybody ever read anything about C.S. Lewis? Chronicles of Narnia. Who's here read the Chronicles of Narnia? Anybody ever read Mere Christianity? Mere Christianity was one of the most important Christian books of the 20th century. If you haven't read Mere Christianity, you need to do it. C.S. Lewis was an atheist. Started off as an atheist. Became more of an atheist when he fought in the trenches of World War I. He went back to school, a little university called Oxford, and he met another writer, a Catholic writer, by the name of J.R.R. Tolkien. J.R.R. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis began to have these weekly meetings in a pub, of all places. A pub. You heard a line, know that? I sat in the pub. I sat at the table that J.R.R. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis discussed faith. And J.R.R. Tolkien convinced C.S. Lewis not to become a Christian, but to at least become an agnostic by one simple statement. C.S. Lewis looked at J.R.R. Tolkien and said, "But what if you're wrong?" And all J.R.R. Tolkien said is, "Clive." That was C.S. Lewis' first name, by the way. "Clive." The question is not, what if it's wrong? The question is, what if it's right? What if I'm right? What if Jesus was right? C.S. Lewis didn't get on his knees right then and there and pray the sinner's prayer and become a full born-again Christian. No, but his ears began to open to the truth. And by the end of his life, C.S. Lewis would become the greatest Christian apologist, the greatest Christian defender of faith of the 20th century. And that doesn't include the countless stories within the Bible that we find common people doing impossibly uncommon things. Esther was an orphaned child. She had come from utter nothing. The Jews of her generation before her had been in captivity. Her faith had been scattered. And the only person she had to take care of her was a cousin, Mordecai. This woman, this common woman that we're going to read about, would become queen and would save her people from annihilation. I think if you ask Esther, before all of this story that we're about to experience occurs, I think if you were asked, Esther, how do you see your life playing out? How do you see your faith? She would tell you, "I'm just a common Jew. I'm just a common person of faith. There's nothing significant about me." Maybe somebody would compare themselves greater to Esther. "I know I got a problem, but at least I'm not that widow girl that lives with her cousin over there." God chooses the unlikely to do the impossible. Because again, what we find in Scripture, God does not speak audibly often to his people, because at the end of the day, it must be a decision on faith. It must be a choice. We seek God in the variety of ways that he speaks to us. And throughout Scripture, the way God usually speaks to us is through his acts of intervention through the acts of showing beyond the shadow of a doubt that indeed God is at work here. The founder of the Methodist Church, John Wesley, if you compared the end of his life, he died. He was old. He was a little old man. By the way, he was 5'3", I believe. You can imagine that. He was about right here to me. That's small. I'm just going to throw that at you. He died, and in his will, the wealth he left was 2 silver spoons and enough money to pay for the men who carried his casket. Oh, he left something else. The Methodist movement, which by the time John Wesley had died had become one of the most fastest growing religious movements in the world. And is still to this day the largest Protestant movement in the world. If you had compared Wesley in his dying day and judged him merely by his appearance and his wealth and his status, would have said he amounted to nothing. And yet every Pentecostal church, every Methodist church, every Wesleyan church, every Nazarene church, every Church of God, every Salvation Army station that you see, would not exist if it were not for this one man who answered the call. Quit comparing your faith to others. And quit feeling as a failure because you struggle to hear the voice of God. It's hard to hear the voice of God in today's world, amen? You have a lot more distractions today than they did back in those days. A lot more noisemakers and a lot more information being thrown in our faces. But what we're going to learn from Esther is that you can become a mighty servant of the Lord and never hear God's voice once. You can be a devout servant of God, a devout believer in the majesty and wonders of God Almighty, and not hear his voice once. You can go from being a peasant orphan to being the queen that saves your people without hearing God's voice once. But always knowing that God is right there and that God is the one making it happen. Are we ready to journey through Esther, my friends? Good. My last comparison is, think of the good, the bad, and the ugly. We're going to meet some characters in here that are good. We're going to meet some characters in here that are bad. We're going to meet some characters in here that are ugly. What I mean is they're really not smart people. So my challenge to you is actually to go home and read the first chapter of Esther. Why should I have all the fun? Read the first chapter of Esther this week and prepare to come back as we talk about just what has to happen for Esther to start the road to becoming queen. I'm going to ask, let's see 2 youth out in the congregation. Why don't y'all come on up here this morning? Thank y'all so much for being here. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and drink, take and eat from this, all of you. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup. And he gave thanks over it and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant put out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Kneel at the altar and pray for as long as you like, and you may return to your seat. But just know that this table, this meal has been prepared for you, not by any denomination, but by the hands of Jesus Christ. And then when we partake in it, we join in holy communion with all of our brothers and sisters of the Christian faith. I would invite you now to come forward if you feel called. out that you didn't want to hear. Maybe life has just not turned out the way you want it to turn out. There is no better place to be than the house of the Lord on Sunday morning.
Amen.
Because it reminds us that even in the darkest times, I want you to think a minute. What people have prayed for in this house. This church was founded in 1900. People prayed here during the Great War, World War I. They prayed during the Depression. They prayed during World War II. They prayed in all the conflicts, assassinations, and calamities that this world has thrown at it. It survived two pandemics of Spanish flu and COVID-19. And there were some days, I'm sure, that the only thing that kept the people who have sat in these pews going was the idea that Sunday was coming. And there was another chance for us to worship and love and grow together. Amen? So whenever you feel as though that devil's on your back, just remember, Sunday's coming. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
were dancing? I can hear.